So hi, everyone. Thanks for coming to my talk, the first talk of Berlin Buzzwords, I guess. So how many of you here have heard about Apache Mahout? Oh, yeah, pretty much everyone. OK, great. There's been a great relationship between Berlin, the city of Berlin, and Apache Mahout, because the project was conceived by folks from Berlin back in the day, back in 2008. Isabel and Carl Wheaton, I guess they're here somewhere. And the first few releases of Apache Mahout would always happen during the Berlin Buzzwords times, when that's when all the commuters get together in Berlin, they work on a release. So for example, the 0.7 release happened during 2012 Berlin Buzzwords, and 2013 Berlin Buzzwords was 0.8 release. So yeah, there is a lot of close relationship between Apache Mahout project and Berlin, and some of the early contributors to the project came from TU Berlin. So who am I? I presently work at Red Hat in the office of CTO as a senior engineer, principal engineer. I'm a member of Apache Software Foundation, and until last year, I was the PMC chair for Apache Mahout, and I handed over the baton to the next guy in the line. So I work on different projects on the PMC chair, and that's my Twitter hashtag. So today, folks, Apache Mahout was conceived as a MapReduce, machine learning on MapReduce in the good old days on Hadoop. And back in 2013, we kind of wanted to revamp the project and redefine the project. So pretty much turn the whole project upside down and build something new altogether. So we were kind of like, OK, what do we do? What is it? How can we differentiate ourselves with others that are coming out, like Spark MLLib and R TensorFlow? So the one thing, the idea that we came up with was most of the data scientists are R programmers. They come from an R background. But R being R, it's not distributed, it's not scalable. What if we could provide R-like semantics in a scalable way, making it agnostic to the backend? You can run it on Spark or Flink or whatever platform next. And as a data scientist, I don't need to know what Spark RDDs are or what Flink data streams are. And all that I care about is writing my algorithm, try it out, see if it works, tear it down, try something different. As long as I can provide the linear algebraic constructs for a data scientist, I can pretty much run my R codes, R-like code, in a Scala DSL in a distributed way. So today we'll be talking about what is Apache Mahout today, and what is Mahout-Samsara. So I'll tell you the story behind Samsara, how we came up with the name. Distributed SVD, eigenfaces, and we have Zeppelin integrations. So we have integration with Apache Zeppelin. You can write up your code in Zeppelin. You can do the visualization. You can do the plotting using ggplot in Zeppelin. Thanks to Trevor, who is here. Trevor, hands up. OK. And as of the latest release, we also have integration with GPU. So much so, we had a talk at NVIDIA GTC conference last month in San Jose. And what's coming next in the pipeline? So what is Apache Mahout today? We wanted to create an environment which is scalable and highly performant, and wherein you can roll your own algorithms, machine learning algorithms, and you can roll your own algorithms and tear it down. So we have a mathematically expressive Scala DSL, and we'll be looking at an example of what the DSL looks like. And we have a collection of pre-canned math and statistics algorithms like SSVD and PCA, principal component analysis, and distributed SSVD, and logistic regression. And you can pretty much run your code on Spark or Flink or on CUDA with a CUDA backend or on CPUs. And as of the latest release, we also have solvers, native solvers that can run on the JVM in CUDA, in GPUs, CPUs, and OpenGLASS. So we'll be looking at that. So the recent work on the project, April 2015, was when we had the first release, the new Mahout release, which was away from MapReduce. That's when we retired the entire MapReduce algorithms. And we came up with this name as Samsara. OK, the name Samsara. So since this was supposed to be a distributed math library, and Mahout is obviously, the origins of Mahout is, it's an Indian name. It's a Hindi word. It's a guy who tames the elephant. So we were kind of looking for a Sanskritish term for algebra. Obviously, the Sanskrit word for that is Ganita. So when we started looking on the GitHub, there was a project that already had the name Ganita. And guess what? They were using Apache Mahout math library under the hood. So there were two options. Either we be good citizens and choose a different name, or pretend that we never saw that and just go with Ganita. So we chose to go with a different name. So what would be the name? So one of the guys, Andrew, came up with the name Samsara, which is, again, a Sanskrit name for something that's ephemeral, that you can tear, you know, something that rejuvenates itself over a period of time. So that's what Mahout-Samsara is. In Feb 2016, we had a book on Mahout, and it's available on Amazon. It's, I think the price as of today is $13 in US, $15, I guess, yeah. So by Andrew Palumbo and Dimitri Libino. And definitely get the book. And I do have to warn you that it's highly mathematical. So yeah, it's for the mathy guys. And as of April 2016, last year, we added Apache Flink as one of the backend engines, execution engines. And as of November 2016, we have Apache Zeppelin integration, thanks to Trevor, for visualization. And the last release we had was in April this year, wherein we have native backend support for GPUs and CPUs. So we have CUDA backend support. And the upcoming release is going to have CUDA solvers and Scala 2.11 support. So what is Mahout-Samsara? So it's Mahout-Samsara is basically an easy-to-use DSL for large-scale machine learning in, that can run on top of Spark or Flink as of today. So for example, if I have this equation here, it's a very simple equation, right? And the way you write that in Samsara is that's it. That's the syntax in Samsara. OK, so this runs on a distributed Spark cluster or a Flink cluster, and you don't see any Spark code or Flink code here. So that's the beauty of what we have. So we kind of built an abstraction engine on top of Spark and Flink. And it took us 2 years to build that. And guess what? In April of 2016, Google announced Beam project, which was pretty much doing an abstraction on every streaming engine. So this is how you would write Samsara DSL expressions. And this gets translated by the backend execution engines. It's optimized under the hood for the backend execution engines. And as of today, we have support for RDDs and Flink datasets. So some of the basics of Samsara, this is the linear algebra constructs that we have. So for example, if you have a scalar real values, that's how you define a scalar real value, val x equal to this. This is Scala syntax. So we have two types of matrices and vectors, in-core and distributed. In-core is in-memory and distributed. So for an in-memory vectors, we have, that's how you define it, dvec. So that's a vector of 1, 0, and 5. And this is SVEC, it's a dense vector. And SVEC is a sparse vector. So that's how you define this for in-memory vectors, sparse and dense. And for a matrix, the last example is you have a dense matrix that's in-memory. And we have a number of specialized matrices for a different, like for example, row matrix and column matrix, and you have special So the other types of matrices that we have is called distributed row matrices, DRM. And this is pretty much the big selling point in Apache Mahout, the DRMs. So it's a huge matrix that is partitioned across the cluster. It's either partitioned by rows, or you can partition it by blocks of the matrix. It lives in the main memory of the cluster. And it does provide a small set of parallelized operations since it's a distributed row matrix and some of those operations are not idempotent, so we provide a subset of parallel operations. And each operation is lazily evaluated per execution. So let's look at an example here. So some of the matrix vector scalar operators are, so for example, for a DRM A is a distributed row matrix A, and that's a distributed row matrix B. So can you tell me what is the symbol in between DRM A and DRM B, if anyone is from R background? It's a matrix multiplication. OK, that's how you do a matrix multiply. So the next line is A multiplied X. A is a matrix and X is a vector. This is R syntax, but it's running on a Scala DSL, running in a distributed fashion on Spark and Flink. So the next one is A transpose times distributed row matrix B. And the other one is a regular matrix multiplication, A times B. You can also slice and dice the matrices. So for example, you have a matrix A. So I take rows 5 until 20, columns 3 until 40. So that's my submatrix that I'm extracting out. Also, I can take A, the row 5, and all the columns in 5. That's the syntax here. This is pretty much an R syntax, what you're seeing here. And A55 is the cell 5. So assignments, some of the assignments that we have only work on in-memory matrices, not on distributed row matrices. So for example, if I have an in-memory matrix A and a row 5, I assign the value of x to all the columns in the row 5. Okay, and anyone know what this means? What is this is doing? It's A times B, and I assign the value back to A. Okay, so if you're doing a dot operations or cross products or dot products, you have x dot y. So vector x and vector y, you can do a dot product x dot y, and a cross product x cross y.
Excuse me, one moment. We have to help the other Kesselhaus because their microphone is broken. So we have to switch. You get this one.
Okay.
And.
Okay. So we also provide certain things like you can summarize the row, the matrices. You can create the number of rows in the matrices. A dot n row gives you the number of rows in the matrices. A dot column sums gives you the sum of all the columns in each column in the matrix. So x dot length is the length of the vector. B dot row means gives you the means of all the rows in the matrix B. So you have some of these. And if you're trying to do a linear solver, it's as simple as x equal to solve A and B. So we also have decompositions like QR decomposition and Cholesky decomposition. So QR is, if you do a QR decomposition, you get a Q matrix and an R matrix. So that's what is returned for the in-memory matrix. This is the in-memory version, so QR. And similarly for Cholesky, it is CHOL. We have the method already built in. And eigenvalues and SVD, if you're doing SVD, singular value decomposition. All of these are in-memory operations. We also have distributed operations for each of them. So similarly, the distributed decompositions. The difference is that you are using a DRM here, not an in-memory matrix. So thin QR, this gives you a DRM Q and an in-memory R. And if you're doing a distributed SSVD, DSSVD, distributed SSVD, you get back a U, V, and a S matrix, and you specify the in-memory DRM A. And the DRMs can be cached. So if you're doing iterative computations, you can cache the DRMs and use the same DRM cache DRM again for the next iteration. So you can checkpoint the DRMs, and you can also uncache the DRMs. So we also have some unary operators. So just run through a few examples here. So for example, you define a dense matrix here. And so that's all it takes to define a dense matrix. And that's the output you get. So we have a command line, just like a Spark REPL. We have a Mahout Spark REPL by which you can do this. And if you're trying to calculate the log of a matrix, of any memory matrix, that's all you have to do. And a signum, I think signum gives you the value 1 if it is greater than 0, and if it returns you a 0 if it is less than 0. So it's one of the operations. Yes, so more examples here about negative numbers. How does it work on negative numbers? So any questions so far before I go into the next one? So the distributed row matrix, this is pretty much what we use for writing our algorithms and making them scalable across clusters. So I can read an in-memory matrix A, MXA, and I can parallelize it, make it, create a DRM out of it, distributed row matrix, by calling this DRM parallelize function. And I can do that, and I can run a log on the DRM function, and I can do a collect. It collects all the results and brings it back to the driver, the main driver, the aggregated results. So for example, here, this is an example of a distributed row matrix that's an output of what you had here. So let's look at some of the, we do some smart algebraic optimizations under the hood when you write your expressions here. So let's look at an example of A transpose A. How is it optimized? Sorry, this is slow. So some of the optimizations we do at runtime are, if I'm doing an A transpose A, the execution is deferred. It's not evaluated right away, it's deferred. And first you compose your logical operators on this. And so implicitly we trigger an optimization and we kind of create an execution plan. We create several execution plans and we select the best execution plan for this. It's just like how you do a database. If you do a database query, you don't tell the database, OK, I want my query to be fetched in this way, all the rows to be fetched in this way. The database decides what is the most optimal way of getting the results back. So we kind of do that under the hood. So for example, for matrix multiplication, we have five different physical operators for different execution paths for matrix DRM A and DRM B. And if you're trying to multiply a distributed row matrix and an in-memory row matrix, we have two different operators. Similarly, if you have a distributed row matrix and a vector, we have one operator, and we have one operator for the other way around. Thank you. Yeah, thank you. So continuing on the optimization path, so some of the common computational paths are, for example, if I'm doing a transpose of a matrix times a matrix, we, instead of doing that, we do a self-squared of A plus B. We'll see an example of how this works. And for tracking partitions, identically partitioned sets, we can do a zip versus a join under the in the physical execution plan. And so in case you have rows that are missing, duplicate rows, or you have rows that are missing values, we kind of, we either do an average or impute the values. So if you're doing matrix multiplications, and depending on whether it's a tall and skinny matrix or if it's a dense matrix, we have a slim version and a wide version of optimizing the multiplications, algebraic operations. So let's look at an example that's much clearer. So let's say we are trying to do A transpose A, computation of A transpose A. So this is how you would write the code. That's the code you write. And what happens under the hood is, the naive way of doing it is, you do it at two pass. The first pass, you transpose A. Okay, and when you transpose A, you have to repartition the entire matrix. And since the rows and the columns have to be swapped, right? And the machines need to send the data all over the network to all the worker nodes. And you need to reshuffle all the data set. And it's a very expensive operation, A transpose, if you're running it in a distributed way. So that's the first pass. And the second pass, you multiply the result of A transpose with A. And again, you have to repartition all of your data, ship all the data, and reshuffle all the data again. So is this the most efficient way of doing it? It's not. So screw that. Let's move on to something more efficient. So the way we do it is something called transpose times self, which is more efficient. It's a single pass algorithm. So these are some of the things that is taken care of under the hood when you're writing your Scala DSL and it's optimized under the hood for execution. So basically what the logical optimization does is it rewrites the plan to use the transpose times self matrix operator, which is a special operator we have. So the way the transpose time self works is, if you're trying to compute A transpose A, we kind of do something called a row outer product formulation. Yeah, some of this is going to be highly mathy, and if your linear algebra is kind of, it's okay, please bear with me. Sorry about that. So it does a row outer product formulation. So the first pass, you have a row partitioned distributed row matrix, and what you do is, for each row in the matrix, for each row in A transpose A and each column in A transpose A and each row in A, what we do is we multiply the first column and the first row, okay? And this happens on one worker node. And each of the rows are distributed on different worker nodes. So we multiply the first column and the first row. Similarly, the second column and the second row. So the third one and the third row. So in the mapper functions, you can pretty much do this in a separate mapper function. And you can finally aggregate the results you can finally aggregate the results back in the reduced phase from each of them. So you collect each of those worker nodes via data, and you just aggregate them back. So this is one of the smart operations optimizations we do under the hood. So I guess this is clear to most folks now. So this is at the logical layer. So we have a physical layer, physical execution layer. So what happens in the physical layer is, so we have two physical operators for transpose time self operation. So one is A transpose A, standard operator. We have a transpose A slim for tall and skinny matrices, which is a special operator. So the optimizer chooses which one to go with based on the, some heuristics that we have. The number of columns in the matrix, we have some threshold. If it's beyond this number of columns, then it's not a skinny matrix. And also based on the cost and how many intermediate results are we likely to produce. And based on that cost of that, we try to choose the best algorithm out of the two. So this is about the way the logical and the physical translation works in the Mahout-Samsara. Any questions so far before I go to the following slide? So there is an algorithm in Mahout thanks to one of our committers, Pat Farrell. And he's pretty much running his consulting business on this. And it's part of Prediction.io. It's called correlated cross-occurrence. It's something that Ted Dunning came up with. The name was conceived by Ted Dunning. And it's basically a multimodal recommender. You can recommend user products as well as content-based recommendations. It's kind of a universal recommender that we have built. So it's based on some of the concepts that Ted Dunning had come up with in the past, and also a research paper from Sebastian. I don't know if he's here, from TU Berlin. So this is something that we have, and it's part of the Prediction.io project. So we can compute the cross occurrences of all the user and item pairs, and based on the user preferences, we can convert the user. You can see the conversion history of all users, and how, based on the user interactions in the past. So this is kind of a digression from the regular talk, and this can be a complete talk by itself. And I'm just giving an overview. So this is an equation that we have for computing the recommendations for users. So HA. The small ha is a single user's history of conversion, and hb is a single user's history of interactions, and r are the recommended items from a, even if there's no ha, and every cross occurrence is found with a transpose a operators and tested for correlation with LLR. LLR is the log likelihood ratio. So the cool thing about Mahout as we have today is it's backend agnostic. The programming is backend agnostic. All the code you saw so far, it runs on Spark and Flink. And you don't see a single line of Spark code or a Spark RDD or Flink dataset. So an example is, this is a screenshot from a Zeppelin notebook. And it's basically doing a linear regression. And all the way up to the green line, all the way below the green line, it's the same code running on Spark and Flink. Okay. The only thing you need to define is a Flink distributed context for Flink and a Spark distributed context for Spark. And below that is the same code that's running on both Flink and Spark platforms. So we are completely engine agnostic. We have completely, you know, abstracted ourselves from backend engine. So any questions on this so far? Which is the fastest? Spark is the fastest for a different reason, not because Flink is slow. It's just that the Flink dataset APIs have not matured much, and they've gone completely streaming. So, but so far, I think Spark is fastest. Has it changed now? No, yeah. So, okay, I just got a 10-minute warning. So next is we'll talk about distributed stochastic singular value decomposition. And so folks are familiar with what SVD is, singular value decomposition? Yeah, no. Okay, so basically you decompose a matrix, k rank of a matrix, such that, and you get three different matrices, U, E, and V. So U is the left singular value vectors, singular vectors, and right, V is the right singular vectors, and E is a diagonal matrix with all the singular values. So this is based on a dissertation by Nathan Halko, and that's what we have been using for the implementation. And SSVD kind of exploits something called the Johnson-Lindenstrauss lemma, okay, from linear algebra. So the length of a random vector is projected onto a sufficiently high-dimensional space, R of D. and from another high-dimensional space. And this means that the distribution will be the projection will be highly distributed across the mean. So just that's the math part of it, which I'll avoid. So in the way you do DSSVD in Mahout is it's the first line there. That's pretty much all it is. Distributed stochastic singular value decomposition. So the DRM is your input, K is the requested decomposition rank, and P is the oversampling parameter, and the number of power iterations you want to go through. Yeah, and of course, that's the math part of it. The K plus P must satisfy the requirement that it's less than the rank of the matrix. So this is something that we can use for a demo called eigenfaces, and it's from the same paper, eigenfaces. So if you're not familiar with eigenfaces, it's a set of eigenvectors used for human face recognition. So before we had convolutional networks, people would use eigenfaces. So we have a small set of images to represent the original training image. And we use dimensionality reduction to detect the images, the faces. And basically, when you train your SSVD by this, you have weights. It gives you a UV and E matrix, and you have a collection of weights, eigenvectors, that you use for classifying the images. It's kind of a nearest neighbor classification. So basically, you're projecting your query images onto a face, onto a span of eigenvectors, and finding the closest match. Okay. So some of the code for this is, so this is the code in a Zeppelin notebook, thanks to the guy there. And so you can download the faces data set. And so these are the beautiful faces that we have. So this is a data set that you have. It's faces in the wild. And so you load the images, and then you set up your Mahout context. Here we are doing the Spark context here. And then we kind of create a DRM, a distributed row matrix from the vectorized images. So that's the code you have for doing that. You're creating an RDD, DRM RDD, and converting that into a DRM, wrapping that into a DRM. And so going forward, I think we need to subtract the means. Yeah. So the way the eigenfaces works is you take all the images, you subtract the means of all the images from each of the images, and then you once you have that, you can use distributed SSVD on the subtracted mean images to calculate the U and V matrices. So now I can use that U and V matrix to predict a new image that comes in. So we can. Yeah. So here I can. So once I have a new image that comes in, and this is what the U vector is going to look like, the grayscale images of the input. And using that, I can bring in a new image. It kind of creates a, calculates an eigen, using an eigen function, it calculates the nearest image to what it's close to. So the cool thing we have now in Mahout is it's got a complete integration with Apache Zeppelin. So it's both for the Spark as well as the Flink backends. And you can pretty much write all of the eigenfaces code that you saw. It was in a Zeppelin notebook. And so you can take this code, and it's all running in a Zeppelin notebook now. And you can also plot. So you can also plot in Zeppelin. You can create different plots. You can visualize your plots. And you can simulate data, and you see the visualizations. So this is a different visualization again. It's so the cool thing we have now is, as of the latest release, we have GPU backend support, thanks to NVIDIA folks, and we have a committer from NVIDIA who's also working with us, and he's a committer on Mahout. And we now have CUDA support. So this is the entire stack that we have, the entire Mahout architecture as it is today. At the very high level, that's where the data scientists write their code, at the application code level. And then we have a Scala R-like DSL, which is translating the application code into the R-like DSL. and then converting that into a logical plan, and then the physical operators come in. And then the physical operators are being optimized for Spark and Flink backend engines. And you can run, that's your compute platform. And now we have something called a VNSCL. It's a math library that can support both CUDA as well as CPUs, GPUs as well as CPUs. And we can run it in memory, or you can run it on a distributed platform, all of the different matrices. And but now that we have GPU integration, this is how it's going to be. If I have to compute A times A B transpose, this is how it's going to compute on a GPU cluster. So basically, the master schedules the tasks to run on each of the slaves. And the matrix multiplication is delegated. You create blocks of in-core blocks of each of the distributed matrices, rows, and send it to each of the slaves. And the computation happens on each of the slaves, and the results are fed back to the master for aggregation. And you really don't need to know any CUDA programming to do this. It's all abstracted out at the back end. So that's a new abstraction we have, CUDA backend. And we have been doing some benchmarks with some of the stuff. So if you're doing a sparse matrix multiplication with a 1,000 by 1,000 matrix and a 1,000 by 1,000 matrix, it's taking us 0.2 seconds with 5 runs. And in the JVM, it's running at the runtime is 1,500 milliseconds. In a CUDA, it's 49 milliseconds. So definitely, there's a lot of improvement with CUDA. There's a 30x speedup. Similarly, for sparse matrix multiplication with 1,000 by 1,000. Geometry of 1,000 by 1,000 times, and the density is 0.02, and we are seeing a 34 milliseconds versus 4 milliseconds on CUDA. So definitely CUDA is much faster than running it on JVM.
Yep.
So since this is a completely volunteer project that's driven by entire volunteers, and none of us are paid to even work on this, and nevertheless this project is still surviving, I usually call out the entire team in one slide. So some of these guys, this is the past as well as the present folks who are active on this. Some of them are, half of them are local to Berlin. So Isabel, Lucas, Steve, Sebastian, Zeno, Alexi, they're all from Berlin. So yeah, this is the team that's actively working on this project still. And any references and pointers to the project? We have Trevor's blog, we have Dimitri's blog, and of course we have a book, which is available on Amazon, and we can be contacted on the mailing list, and that's our Twitter handle. And any questions? Yeah.
Can you talk about the cooperation between this, okay. We'll be interested because I know more TensorFlow. What's your comparison with TensorFlow? Use case, maybe, or the performance?
We didn't do any benchmarks with TensorFlow yet, no. So far, all the benchmarks we have been doing is running it on the JVM with Spark and running it on CUDA, and what is the difference between that? No, we have not done any benchmarks with TensorFlow. Do you have any?
Well, use case, it wouldn't be a benchmark, but a use case. It's Scala-based, TensorFlow's Python.
Yeah. Yeah.
How would you compare Mahout at the moment to H2O?
H2O and Mahout. Well, H2O definitely has a very good user interface, I would say, and that's their big selling point. And Mahout, none of us are artists, and so we don't have a good user interface. And I don't know about scalability of H2O. I think it's all in memory, right? Most of the computation happens in memory, whereas we have in memory as well as distributed modes of execution. So, yeah. We used to have H2O as one of the other backends, which I didn't talk about that here, but we do support H2O as a backend too. So you can run Mahout on H2O. But it's not being maintained, so I didn't talk about it. It's not being maintained.
Hi. Thank you for the talk. It's pretty interesting. What I think is, this is pretty much like low level.
Yeah.
Like, and it gives a lot of power to the mathematicians who are pretty much familiar. Now, let's say we have two use cases. We have to go for production ready. Now, on the one hand, you have like Python, TensorFlow, this stack of thing, and where you really don't need to care about this nitty-gritty mathematical things, versus where you're fiddling around distributed metrics.
So this is.
So which one would you suggest?
So this, the way built is, this is basically for practitioners, data science practitioners. Okay. So yeah, definitely you have a stats background and a math background. This is useful for you. And well, yeah, in colleges, people are being taught Python today instead of C or Java. And so we have way too many data scientists who don't understand math. And yeah.
Any questions left?
Yeah.
Zeno?
Sorry, Sebastian and Isabel are here. I didn't see them. So they're Isabel is the founder of the project. She's the founder of Berlin Buzzwords too. Co-founder, sorry.
Just
and Sebastian was one of the early committers on the project. Yeah.
Just a short question. So you are basically building a lot of stuff around matrices, etc.
Yeah.
Do you plan any stuff around neural networks? Because that's basically
it's in the works, and it's definitely in the works, and you should see that coming in the next version, next releases.
Thank you.
Yeah. Now that we have CUDA backend, so that's definitely the next step to go to.
Suneel, thank you very much for this talk. Give them a hand.